How many of you lift weights or do CrossFit? Raise your hands. Go ahead. I want to see hands all over this worship center raised, okay? I see some hands. I mean, isn't it great to lift weights? I mean, I like powerlifting in particular because it makes me feel Arnold Schwarzenegger-ish. You know, if you think about powerlifting or CrossFit, you think of the three major lifts where you can pack on the most weight. You've got the bench press and the squat. Those are relatively self-explanatory. But then you have the most difficult of the lifts, in my opinion, the deadlift. Now, did you notice the name? I mean, the name in and of itself gives it away. Deadlift. If you're not familiar with the deadlift, it's basically loading up a barbell with as much weight as you can reasonably handle, and then it is bending down, stepping into it, and lifting the weight, and it comes to about thigh or waist level. And then you drop it. A deadlift, picking up a very heavy weight. I have a love-hate relationship with the deadlift. I mean, I love it, it hates me. It seems like whenever I do it, no matter how perfect I think my form is, I tweak my back. I hurt myself, but I've just become accustomed to it. Well, prior to coming to Crossroads, we were living in Spokane. And I was working out at Gold's Gym in Spokane, and I was doing my deadlifts, and all of a sudden I felt that, that twinge in my back. I tweaked my back, but I have done it so many times that I just didn't think a whole lot of it. Well, lo and behold, this tweak turned into a severe injury. It lasted almost 2 years. So at month 16, Lori said, I can't take this anymore. You are writhing in pain. You are screaming in your sleep. You don't wake up, but I do. I mean, I don't know why she was so upset about that. She said, whether you like it or not, I'm going to make you an aquatic physical therapy appointment. I said, no, I'm not going. She said, yes, you are. I said, yes, ma'am. I went into the aquatic physical therapy appointment. I'm in my swim trunks. I'm gingerly limping around. And I will tell you this, I am a relatively secure man. But when I walked into the pool, I noticed that there were four fit women waiting to rehabilitate me. And all of a sudden, I'm like, I'm feeling a little sheepish. Do you know what these four ladies taught me to do? They taught me to stand. They said, we want you to adopt a shoulder-width stance. We want you to spread the floor. Spread the floor with your feet. Tighten your core. Tighten it. And then you know what they did? These ladies began to push on me. While I'm trying to stand there and do everything that they're telling me to do, they tried to push me over. They began to explain to me that core strength is what protects your back, and it's what allows you to do routine acts, but also be able to lift weights. It has to do with you being able to stand strong with core strength. How do you stand strong spiritually? Some of us know how to stand strong physically. I do now. We know how to stand strong mentally and emotionally. Many of us do. But how do we stand strong spiritually? How do we stand strong spiritually when suffering hits our lives? Physical, mental, emotional, financial, relational, or even spiritual suffering. How do we stand strong? That's the question that the Apostle Paul is going to address in Philippians 1. So turn with me to Philippians 1. And the Apostle Paul is going to help us to be able to and he's going to give us an important truth today. And that is, live as citizens of heaven and model the gospel. He wants us to model the gospel, even in the midst of suffering and hardship. Paul's going to give us two important exhortations in Philippians chapter 1, verses 27 through 30. Yes, we are only looking at four verses, but I will still take my time. Now, the first exhortation you'll see in verses 27 and 28, and that is, stand strong for Christ. The Apostle Paul is going to say, if you don't stand for something, you will fall for everything. He wants us to have core convictions. He wants us to have spiritual strength. He believes that you find spiritual strength in humility and in unity with the body of Christ. So let's look at this very first phrase in verse 27. Paul begins with the word only. Only this, just this one thing. In other words, he's going to say, this is the most important thing I could say to you. My guess is, if he was here, he'd have his index finger up like I do. Paul then says, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Now, conduct yourselves is the first command in the letter of Philippians. So if we back up chapter 1, verse 1, all the way through verse 26 has been Paul talking about his experience. Now he turns to the Philippians and he begins to exhort them in the midst of their experience. Instead of using the first person, I, he moves to you, or you all. If you're from the South, y'all. He's speaking to the body of Christ. And he uses a particular verb, conduct yourselves. Now, typically, if Paul is talking about how to walk worthily, he will talk about to live or to walk. He'll use two different Greek verbs. Here he uses a verb that he doesn't use anywhere else. And from this verb, we have the root word city. He's telling us to live as citizens, which is how the New Living Translation renders this. But the NLT adds the important phrase, as citizens of heaven. Live as citizens of heaven. And that's what Paul is talking about. You see, to be a part of Philippi was a big deal. I mean, it was a Roman colony, and many Roman generals retired here. This was a place where Rome was esteemed. But Paul is not focused on the citizenship or even Philippi itself. He's not thinking about Rome. He's fixated on the Philippians being citizens of heaven. He's saying, in light of the fact that you're going to spend eternity with Christ, in light of the fact that you're already seated in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, at least positionally, I want you to live out your identity. That's what Paul is saying here. He's saying, I want you to live out your citizenship as a citizen of heaven in the most difficult part of the world, the greater Roman Empire, where you will be opposed, where you will be ostracized, where you will be rejected. I want you to live as citizens of heaven and model the gospel. Now, do you see that phrase in verse 27? A manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. We see that emphasis upon being worthy, which means ultimately to be weighed by both the community and by the Lord in your conduct and be found worthy of God's good news, the gospel. Which is why the Apostle Paul elsewhere says, I want you to walk, I want you to live in a manner worthy of the gospel. Now, this is really helpful to me because as someone who likes to teach, I like to think, oh, there's such an impact in preaching and teaching and writing and even conversations. But in our day and age, do you know what's most meaningful? When Christians simply live their lives in a worthy manner before those who need Christ. That's the loudest sermon that can be preached. That's what people are wanting to hear. They want to observe our lives. They want our lives to reflect that of Jesus. And in this context, that means in the midst of opposition, ridicule, suffering, and even outright persecution, we respond with gentleness. We respond with grace. We respond with the love of Christ. And the community sees that. And it makes a difference because we're conducting ourselves as citizens of heaven. And we know that our time on earth is just a brief sojourn. We're on our way to our heavenly home. And so we try to bring heaven down to earth in our conduct. Paul is now going to explain how to live as a citizen of heaven. I mean, practically speaking, how do we pull this off? And he does that in the second half of verse 27 through verse 28. First of all, he's going to say, stand firm. He's going to say that right in the middle of verse 27. He says, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit. I like this. Paul says, whether I am with you, Philippians, whether I'm present, or whether I'm not with you, whether I'm absent from you, I expect great things from you. Now stop and think about this. Teenagers, when your parents tell you that they're going away for the weekend, I know what you immediately think. Yes! But before you get too excited, your parents are going to immediately say, I want you to conduct yourself like you would if I was present. In other words, no parties, don't go crazy. Employees, when your boss is on a business trip, he's going to say, or she's going to say, I want you to work as if I was here. I don't want you to dial it in. The same is true for students. Often teachers and professors, they will step out of the classroom, and it can often be a test. I used to test my students that way. We want to know how they're going to behave, how they're going to act in our absence. Students need to behave like they would if the teacher or the professor was present. Paul says, I expect this, and I believe it to be true of you, Philippians. If we believe Jesus Christ is going to return, and it could be soon, how should we conduct ourselves? As citizens of heaven. We should live as citizens of heaven, and we should model the gospel. How are we doing that? Many of us are striving to do that even as we're opposed. Some of us are working for corporations where we know that if we remain Christ-like, moral, and ethical, we're not going to get promoted. In fact, some of us run the risk of losing our jobs. At school, we know that if we stand strong for Christ, if we name the name of Jesus, if we take a stance on purity, we're going to be rejected. We're going to be ridiculed. The question is, are we here to model the gospel? Are we desiring to move forward and to live our lives before those who need Jesus? And are we living our lives in order to please the Savior? Paul uses a verb here, stand strong or stand firm, that he uses fairly frequently. But it's important to understand the background for this term is that of Roman soldiers who lock their shields together, who stand back to back, who stand side to side, who move forward as one person. They take a defensive posture to ensure that they will remain strong in the midst of battle. They do it as one, in a united way. So look back again at verse 27, and you'll see standing firm in one spirit. Now, I would actually capitalize spirit. In other words, capitalize that S, because I think Paul is referring to the Holy Spirit, not human spirit corporately. And so what he's saying is we come together in the Holy Spirit. He indwells us, he fills us, and we make the main thing, and we unite in the Spirit of God. Now, if we go back to the Roman soldiers, can you imagine with their locked shields and their spears, if they, in the midst of close quarters, began bickering underneath all the shields and they started talking amongst themselves about things that were relatively insignificant, they'd lose every battle. They're focused on winning against their opponents. Do you know what often keeps the body of Christ from moving forward? We're bickering in our churches. We're bickering in our community groups and in our areas of ministry when we should be keeping the main thing, and moving out into the world, our schools, our neighborhoods, our places of business, and impacting others. But we're squabbling. We're arguing, we're slandering, we're gossiping, and we're hurting the cause of Christ. We're not modeling the gospel the way that God intends. So what we see here is a need to be in a defensive posture, but not as individuals, not as one person, but as the body of Christ. We come together in a unified fashion to be able to fight spiritual battles. We live as citizens of heaven and model the gospel. Now, there's a second way that we can live as heavenly citizens, and you can see that in the latter part of verse 27. Paul writes, "With one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel." So Paul here moves from a military metaphor to an athletic metaphor. In fact, this term that's translated striving together or contend together, the root word is where we get our English word athlete or athletics from. And you probably know that the Greeks and the Romans, they loved sports. They loved wrestling. They loved running. They loved boxing. They loved a lot of great sports. But so many of these are individual sports. So Paul cleverly attaches a prefix before this verb, with, together. He says, instead of seeing the spiritual life as an individual sport, you see it as a team sport. We come together as one, and we strain, we stretch, we fight, we contend, we strive. And notice for the gospel. We keep the main thing, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we make that our battle cry. It's not politics. It's not gender. It's not race. It's not sexuality. It's not some of our other pet topics or interests. As important as all of these are, it's the gospel, which is the good news of Jesus Christ. That's what brings not only Crossroads together, that brings churches together on the east side of Seattle and throughout the state of Washington and throughout our country and throughout our world. Crossroads is not merely focused on Crossroads. We're focused on the global church. We have a heart for the church of Jesus Christ, every tribe, tongue, people, and nation. What brings us together? The good news of Jesus. And I love the fact that this now is not defensive, it's offensive. In other words, the Roman soldiers, they initially defended themselves. They knew that a strong defense was necessary when you were going into battle. But athletes know, as important as great defense is, and some will say that defense wins championships, which I agree with, however, you still need offense. You need to score. And so here Paul takes the defensive posture, the offensive posture, and he says, church, do you want to win in spiritual warfare? Do you want to be able to move the mission and the vision of Christ forward? Here's how you do it. You develop a military mindset. You develop an athletic mindset. Paul is writing not only for the first century, he's writing for the 21st century. And I love the timeless, universal nature of Scripture. He continued to come back to the theme. Live as citizens of heaven who model the gospel. I'll tell you, I can't model much, but I'll try to model the gospel. And I think you and I have that responsibility before God and before a community that desperately needs people who will walk the talk and live it out. So we see a third way that we can conduct ourselves as citizens of heaven in verse 28. Paul is going to say, don't be frightened. He writes, in no way alarmed by your opponents, which is a sign of destruction for them, but of salvation for you, and that too from God. Paul actually bypasses his customary word for fear. And he chooses a word that's not used in the Greek Old Testament or the Greek New Testament. In fact, we have to go outside of the Greek language to understand this term. And it's used in Greek literature of animals who become startled, particularly horses who hear soldiers and they stampede. They become frightened. They become fearful. But there's also a few occurrences of people becoming alarmed when they learn about the death of a loved one. So this is serious fear. Fear in the animal kingdom and fear amongst human beings. And yet Paul says, while fear is ultimately natural, Paul understands that, and Paul became weary and disturbed with persecution. 2 Corinthians tells us a lot about that. He says, I don't want that to be your primary emotion. I don't want that to be your first and natural response. We're no longer slaves to sin. We are children of God. That's what Paul wants us to hear. And if you look at verse 28, he talks about opponents. And if you like to read commentaries and you like to study the biblical text, what you'll find is whenever opponents are brought up, scholars don't know what to do often. And there's a plethora of views. I think the best view is these are people who are neighbors. They're co-workers. And in the case of Philippians, many of them may be governing authorities. So the Philippian church has opponents. And they will ridicule, they will scorn, they will mock, they will persecute the Philippians. The Philippians will run the risk of losing their jobs. They will run the risk of being excluded from relationships with friends, with coworkers, with neighbors, with family members. They're going to suffer. Some of them may eventually lose their lives because of their faith in Jesus Christ. But what does Paul say? He says in verse 28 that ultimately this suffering, it has two purposes. Now, this is a very difficult verse. I won't bog down in the details, but you need to understand that this is a very disputed verse, like many verses in the Bible. But I think the best way of understanding it is, first of all, the suffering that believers experience, it's a sign of destruction to unbelievers. Now, you're probably wondering, well, how is that possible? I think what Paul is saying here is, when unbelievers come against Christians, they do so with great zeal often. But there are also times where if we conduct ourselves as citizens of heaven, and if we respond in our conversation with grace seasoned with salt, if we're willing to forgive our persecutors, if we're willing to love our enemies, if we're filled with joy, like Philippians talks about, the joy epistle, pretty soon those that oppose us begin to think, why is it that I haven't completely obliterated this Christian? I mean, I didn't even think their faith was strong, and here they are, they're continuing to grow strong in their faith, and they're somehow loving me and praying for me in the process of me trying to make their lives miserable. Now, admittedly, a lot of those who oppose us will continue to oppose us with glee for the rest of their lives. But if you're a global Christian, you also know that many persecutors of Christians, when they lay their head on the pillow at night, a still small voice begins speaking to them, what does this follower of Christ have that you don't? How can they live their lives with this type of grace and forgiveness? How can they love the way you don't love? And there are countless persecutors who have come to believe in Jesus Christ as Savior because of the conduct of these citizens of heaven who live in different parts of the world, but obviously should live in our country as well. Wouldn't it be great if unbelievers who opposed us were reminded of their destruction, their imminent doom, and in the midst of that, they turned to faith in Jesus Christ because of observing our lives? I think in our culture, because Christians fight back on social media, and we come up with podcasts and YouTube channels where we just pick apart unbelievers and we can slander and talk trash like nobody's business. I mean, we're fighting fire with fire, and what ends up happening is those that are opposing us say, yep, I was right to oppose them in the first place. But what if instead we find ways to pray for them and to serve them and to love them and to care for them? What difference might that make? Live as citizens of heaven and model the gospel. That's what Paul is saying. May we think very carefully about how we should respond to unbelievers who oppose us. Because the greatest sermon we may ever preach may be how we respond. Do we retaliate, or do we choose to serve, pray, and love? Notice in verse 28, our suffering is also a sign to us. It's a sign of our salvation. It's a sign of our rescue or our deliverance. In other words, not only do we see evidence that we have trusted in Christ and we're new creations in Christ because of how we handle our suffering, but there's also this theme of vindication in the book of Philippians. Whenever salvation or save is used, it's pointing to the fact that one day we will be rewarded for our suffering on earth. We'll be rewarded in eternity. And we will enjoy intimacy with the Savior because of how we have identified with him on earth. Model the gospel. Model the gospel. That's what Paul is saying. How do we do that? We live as citizens of heaven on planet earth. The Philippians were to do that in Philippi. We are to do that on the east side of Seattle. We are to ultimately stand strong. We are to strive together. And then we are to come to the place where we refuse to be intimidated. So what we've seen is we need to stand firm. We need to stand firm in Christ. That's Paul's first exhortation. But then he gives a second important exhortation, one that we're not going to necessarily be too terribly excited about, and that is suffer well for Christ. Paul's going to say, ultimately, in the way that you have experienced the gift of salvation, there is also the gift of suffering. Both are gifts, and I want you to appreciate both gifts. Look with me at verses 29 through 30. Paul writes, "For to you it has been granted for Christ's sake, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, experiencing the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here to be in me." Paul is saying there are two gifts. One is the gift of salvation, the other one is the gift of suffering. Now, how can I make that claim? Well, if you look carefully at verse 29, you'll see this term granted. Paul could have chosen any number of Greek verbs, but he chooses a Greek verb that has as its root grace. Oh, I like this. See, salvation by grace through faith alone, it's a gift that we all want if we're believers in Christ. But the gift of grace that comes through suffering, that's a gift that no one here wants. And yet it's the gift that keeps on giving whether we want it or not. I mean, just think about it. When suffering hits our lives, we want to run as fast as we can and as far away as we can from suffering. But here's what Paul says. He says, embrace the grace of suffering. Paul knows, as he tells the Philippians in verse 30, you've observed and heard about my past suffering. You're seeing me suffer right now. I'm under house arrest. I'm chained to Roman guards. I'm suffering. He knows he'll continue to suffer. But Paul knows the only way to grow to be a great woman or man of God is through suffering. It is the fast track to godliness. See, if everything is going our way, financially, physically, relationally, we will not grow strong in the Lord. But when everything seems to be going wrong and people are opposing us, we have no place to look but to the Lord. And the Lord helps us to grow in Him as a result. Suffering is a gift. It is a grace gift from God. But what do? Like we do when Christmas hits, we receive gifts, and the immediate response is, I don't really like this gift. I don't need this gift. Where's the gift receipt? Well, not everyone gives a gift receipt. You can't always take a gift back and get store credit. But here's the reality. When God gives the gift of suffering, the receipt is your growth in Him. And everything He brings into our lives is a gift from Him. Now, in this context, it's primarily talking about opposition. It's talking about even severe opposition that comes from our faith in Christ. But one of the things I've been thinking a lot about lately is, as a global Christian who reads daily about the persecuted church, I know that many of us don't experience a lot of persecution. And so we always feel like our lives are just so lame. I mean, we got some prosperity, we have some blessing, we have all kinds of things that the global church doesn't. And so we think, my Christian life is just weak. It's sort of pathetic. Yet we know we have suffering. Some of you are suffering right now because you've lost a loved one recently. Your marriage is going through a crisis right now. You have children that are wayward. You have financial woes and you don't know how you're going to make it through. You're struggling physically. Perhaps you do have a significant back issue, or you may have migraines. You may have been recently diagnosed with a very serious illness. This is suffering. And here's what I've had to understand. in Christ, anything that keeps us from living as citizens of heaven, physically, mentally, emotionally, financially, relationally, or spiritually, anything that causes us to be distracted from modeling the gospel and moving forward in our discipleship, that's suffering. And that's a form of suffering that Paul would take seriously. So yes, we will experience great opposition. We're already sensing that in our country and even in our community. But some of you haven't felt that fully yet, but you have felt personal suffering. God wants you to know that He is conforming you. He is molding you. He is shaping you. He is forming you into the believer He wants you to be, and you have the opportunity to model the gospel before an onlooking world. And you also can provide your church and the greater Christian community a shot in the arm by how you model the gospel in the midst of suffering. That's the good news of this passage. That no matter how long we live in this world, at the end of the day, Scripture makes it clear it's a vapor, it's a mist, it's a shadow, it's a breath, it's like grass and a fading flower. Scripture defines our lifespans in these ways. And we're on our way to realize our full citizenship in heaven. So will you embrace suffering? Will you say, I don't like how suffering makes me feel, but I like the results that it brings about in my life as a disciple? Viktor Frankl is a man that many of us are familiar with. He was a Jewish psychologist, and he spent 4 different seasons in German concentration camps, including Auschwitz. He studied the Jewish people while he was in these concentration camps, and he was trying to understand their coping mechanisms. And what he noticed is those individuals that didn't have any purpose, allowed them to see the purpose or the meaning in suffering. Frankl said they died in those concentration camps, many of them. But he said there were some that believed that suffering actually had a purpose, and they were able to see how it related to their faith. And some were even able to endure the atrocities that most of us can't even fathom, and they were able to do so with a sense of joy and purpose. And Frankl said they actually survived, at least some of them did. And when they got out of those concentration camps, they were able to go live their lives with purpose and with meaning. And they could even see why some of these events happened, as difficult and as painful as they were. Some of them were even able to forgive their persecutors. Now, this is an extreme way of looking at suffering. What we need to say is we are all suffering right now. Physically, mentally, emotionally, financially, relationally, we're suffering. Your suffering is to be taken seriously, because the suffering that is in your life right now is the suffering that God has permitted. And God desires to use it for your good and for my good, and ultimately for His glory. Will we embrace it and see God's hidden hand trying to help us to be more like the suffering servant, the Lord Jesus Christ? God wants us to live with joy. He wants us to model the gospel. He knows the only way we can do that is if we adopt an eternal perspective and live our lives as citizens of heaven. Can we do that, Crossroads? Can we commit and renew our commitment today that this is what we will do? Not only for God's glory, but for the sake of a community that's lost and dying and desperately needs Christian witnesses that are worthy, worthy of the gospel. Let's pray together. Father, we acknowledge that We struggle living worthy lives. All of us do. We are sinful people. And yet you continue to keep before us that we're called as citizens of heaven to live worthy lives. Lord, where we are faithless, will you remain faithful? Will you always use us in spite of ourselves? Make us the people you want us to be. Father, we pray for those who are not citizens of heaven right now. You may be here in the worship center or watching online, and you know in your heart of hearts, I am not a citizen of heaven. If I were to die today, or if Jesus Christ were to return, I don't know that I would spend eternity with God. If that's you, it's very simple how you come to faith. You simply give Jesus your sin, and he will give you his righteousness. He will give you his worthiness for your unworthiness. All that you're called to do is to acknowledge your sin, to believe in Jesus Christ's perfect life, his death, his resurrection, and you entrust your eternal destiny to him. You become persuaded that Jesus is who he claims to be, and you place your faith in him alone. Father, we pray that each and every one of us would settle that issue, that we would do business with you today, and that we would acknowledge the Lord Jesus Christ as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We thank you for this time, Lord. Thank you that we can adore your word. Help us to now live it out. In Jesus' name, amen.